same amount of people complaining about lockpick episodes.
Which is dumb.
Yeah.
They're dumb. They're all dumb dummies.
Dumb.
You big dumb dummies. Let's play the beginner's guide. Oh, shit, Joe. Oh, shit. I guess I do mean, oh, shit.
Yeah.
Apparently it won't load. Oh, wait, there you go. Wait, keep talking, nobody explodes. That's not right. Get out of here. No, close. Get out of here.
I'd like to imagine that's, like, your sly way of just being like, no, we're doing it now.
No, dude, we're not doing it without... Okay, here we go.
Can you close that email before you click anything?
Close what?
That email.
Oh, okay. Sure.
Thank you.
All right. Hang on, I gotta open up a thing. Gotta do a thing with a thing. Alright, let me do... Perfect. Looks great, right? Let's do... I can't remember. Show sources settings. Go to local desktop presenter. Change to game. Change the game to... Steam. Where is it? I don't see it. Steam. Oh, the beginner's guide. There we go. Sorry. Yeah, alright. We're almost on to something. Okay, this is really weird. This is going great.
Why don't you bring Wirecast down?
Well, unfortunately, like, I can't... Here we go.
Or go to the second tab for that.
Here we go. How about this? Boom. Right? And then I go back to this. And then I bring back this.
Oh.
There we go. Right? Oh. Okay, and then let's... we'll even stop this. Okay. We're gonna play the beginner's game, and it will be super rad. Can people tweet on my behalf? And
yeah.
Oh man, I'm so excited. Let's take a look at audio video aspect ratio.
So this is a new game from the creator of the Stanley Parable.
Yeah.
It's not the entire team. But it is.
It has a pedigree from related to. Okay, so let me open this Diving up. Tweet out right the... now.
Oh, are you gonna do it?
Yeah, I'll tweet it.
Okay, right,
then we got this. We got this. DiamondClub.tv, right?
Yes. So yeah, this is from the Stanley Parable. If you don't know the Stanley Parable, I think what surprises me the most of the Stanley Parable, I think, is its biggest achievement, is how well it knows what you're going to do.
Yeah.
It knows
you. And you think you... oh, shoot.
You can't outsmart it. Like, and as a video game, like, having ways to be outsmarted is programmed in. So, fundamentally, you were always never smarter than it.
Correct. But it wears it on its sleeve.
Mm-hmm.
Right. Let me see if there's a place for me to put...
Face cam?
Yeah, I guess so. Let's do...
There's not any sort of HUD, so you can kind of put it wherever.
Plus, we'll throw me. Oh, I'm gonna make myself real small. Sorry, I'm gonna cut you off.
Okay.
There we go. Top down, bottom up.
Scare cam, 2K16.
Yeah, no, that's... And
yeah, Brusselberry's right. It's been a while since we had a Schwid play.
I know. That's all on me, and there's really no excuse for it. There we go. Okay. So, I mean, outside of the fact that I felt overworked and entitled to be, you know, a smug jerk. Okay, here we go. We're playing. Audio's on. Done.
Yeah.
Yes. Don't spoil anything for me. I'm going to say a lot of stuff.
I'm not going to say.
I'm going to talk out what's in my mind.
Great. Hi, I'm going to let you know when I want.
Thank you very much for playing the Beginner's Guide. My name is Davey Reedon. I wrote the Stanley Parable, and while that game tells a pretty absurd story, today I'm going to tell you about a series of events that happened between 2008 and 2011. we're going to look at the games made by a friend of mine named Coda. Now, these games mean a lot to me. I met Coda in early 2009 at a time when I was really struggling with some personal stuff, and his work pointed me in a very powerful direction. I found it to be a good reference point for the kinds of creative works that I wanted to make. So just to start you off, this is, I think, the first game he ever made. It's a level for Counter-Strike. You can walk around here, by the way. And mostly it's just Coda learning the basics of building a 3D environment. But what I like is that even though he starts from the simple aesthetic of a desert town, he then scatters these colorful abstract blobs and impossible floating crates around the level. And of course, it destroys the illusion that this actually is a desert town, and instead this level becomes a kind of calling card from its creator. It's like a reminder that this video game was constructed by a real person. And it kind of makes you wonder, what was going through his head as he was building this? This is what I like about all of Coda's games. I mean, not that they're all fascinating as games, but that they are all going to give us access to their creator. I want us to see past the games themselves. I want to get to know who this human being really is. And that's exactly what we're going to do here. It's 2008, Coda starts making these games, and he never releases any of them. He doesn't put them onto the internet, he just makes them and then immediately abandons them and they sit on his computer forever. And I think he really understood this image of himself as a recluse. At one point, he jokingly renamed his computer's recycling bin to Important Games Folder. So, you know, this was just how he worked. He tended to crank them out one after the other without even really pausing to try to understand what he had just made, until suddenly one day, he just stopped. In 2011, that was it. He made his last game, and then he hasn't made another one since. And that's why I've taken this opportunity to gather all of his work together, is because I find his games powerful and interesting, and I'd like this collection to reach him, to maybe encourage him to start creating again. And if the people like you who play this also happen to find his work interesting, then I'm sure it'll just send that much stronger of a message of encouragement to Coda. So thanks for joining me on this. If you have a particular interpretation that I haven't mentioned here, or if you just need to get in touch, you can email me at daveywreden@gmail.com. Okay, that's about it for introduction. Let's take a look at Coda's first proper game. As each game is loading, I'll show you the date that it was completed. This first one was made in November 2008.
Okay, first of all, that was a great, that was close to DE Dust. I wonder if it used the actual textures from it, but it was, of course, neither Dust nor Dust 2.
Warning. Was the machine active? Ship destruction imminent.
This game is called Escape from Whisper, and it's one of the more generic games you'll see from Coda. It kind of looks like this game was abandoned mid-development. For instance, you have this gun, which you'd think would indicate that there are supposed to be monsters or enemies somewhere, but then clearly there are no enemies anywhere. You can't even reload the gun when you run out of bullets. But ultimately, we don't really know. Maybe Coda thought that actually it was complete the way that it is. And I think that we should talk about his games for what they are, rather than for what they're not. I love how you can see the bottom of the universe from this room. Apparently, this space station has a labyrinth on it. I don't know. There's really no reason for it that I've ever been able to discern, so in the interest of time, I'm just gonna skip you on past it. Okay, this is the part that's interesting. The game has this narrative about the Whisper Machine and how it has to be turned off, and then you get to the engine room.
Hey, you there, in the engine room. You could save us all. That being is powering the Whisper Machine. We could disrupt it by introducing a great enough heat signature. If you... your body could stop the beam. It's so much to ask, but for all of our lives, would you do it? Could you give yourself?
I mean, it's just a game, so screw it, right?
Let me pause here for a second. What you just experienced, stepping into the beam and then dying, is probably what Coda had initially intended when he was developing this level. But when he first compiles and plays it, something goes wrong. There's a bug somewhere. And this is what happens instead. The beam causes you to start floating. And this is an important moment for him. Because yes, this is technically a glitch, but Coda identifies something human about it. Like how small it makes you feel in the face of this larger chaotic system. Or this floating could be the afterlife, a peaceful place, juxtaposed against all of the hysteria that you've just had to traverse. I don't even know. I have no idea what he was thinking, but what's clear is that after making this, something lodges itself in his brain. He wants to do more of these really weird and experimental designs. So he stops work on this and moves on to a stream of tiny little games that go in all sorts of directions. Let's go ahead and take a look at the first game he made after leaving this one behind.
I'm already in love with this, for the record.
Yep, in this game you can only walk backwards.
It's amazing.
So it's a short and relatively minimalist experiment combining motion and narrative. It is less advanced than the previous game, but actually it seems to be more focused, more complete. Coda is trying to give it a unique voice rather than simply basing it on a pre-existing trope.
How am I going to open the door?
It's a short little thought, it says what it wants to say, and then it ends. Didn't need anything more than that. Which to me is why it works, because it gets out quick. Okay, next one. And that's it. Okay, the meaning of this game won't be clear just yet. Please be patient with me for a few more games, and I promise you'll see what makes it interesting. Oftentimes, Coda would put bizarre titles like this one at the start of his games. I wish I'd known him at the time that he was making these early games. He would really only talk to me about his work as he was making it. Once he stopped work on a game, like, that was it. It was dead to him. And I don't agree with that at all, but what are you gonna do?
You know what this is? This is the poetry of, like Stephen King's Monkey Shines, or...
Once you've been slowed to an absolute crawl, the door at the top of the stairs opens. So why, if Coda's not showing these games to anyone, why bother opening the door at all? Well, to show you, I'm modifying the game here so that when you press enter, it'll bring you back up to full speed so you can enter the door for yourself.
Kind of tempted not to, because by his own admission, he's altering the game. And I'm not accusing the game of trying to pull a trick on me or anything, but it's the nature of... it's the nature of anthologies and of short stories to share a bigger story.
Mm-hmm.
And oftentimes there's a reason for things. And essentially this is an anthology of short stories tied together by the narrative of this, what I assume is a fictional author, Coda, this mad genius of creating video games. And I'm certainly intrigued enough to, at least at this point, we'll see how I feel later.
You're getting there.
Well, I mean, yeah, it's, I mean, you know, maybe that's the purpose of this, not only in Coda's vision for the game, but in the reality of playing the beginner's guide. Because we've been taught things like to walk backwards and...
So this is a... more of just a minor inconvenience.
Yeah, right.
Than being given, sort of like the labyrinth in the space puzzle. If you,
well, exactly.
If you were back in that level,
I kind of wished that I had the chance to solve the labyrinth.
Mm.
And again, I mean, that's what is a video game but an inconvenience turned into a novelty, right? And
interesting.
And so to have the inconvenience removed almost I don't want to say robs us, but it certainly shapes a larger narrative.
Well, I could say I can appreciate your choice here. I mean, that's what you're doing here, is you're just making a choice. And not even like a capital C choice. You're just...
Do you know what I'm doing? I'm doing the same thing I did on the Stanley Parable, which was the very first time I played through it. It clearly told me to take the left door, and I remember thinking like, well, let me just see what's behind the right door first. And it set me on this whole track that was totally different from the stated narrative of the game. Mm-hmm. And I guess clearly the narrative says press enter and you'll skip this, but some part of me wonders if, even if nothing changes... even if this decision to do the hard thing is logged, and if it factors into the, I guess it's that whole the road less traveled thing, I guess. I don't know. But I certainly am eagerly anticipating what's behind this door more.
Well, in that sense, the game is sort of successful. I mean, outside of the fact that it wasn't released to anybody... it's giving you an emotion of anticipation and tension.
Well, and that's what's great is that short stories are not novels, comic books are not television shows, and video games are not movies. You know, it's they're all different. I wonder if I have to do everything this slow now. Fuck you.
Can you read some of those out?
Yeah. Game filled with chair, except one chair is floating. From the captain, the captain is out.
A room that's warm and nice and filled with little ideas for games.
A normal game where you have to scream into a
mic. Coda would often tell me that he didn't mind if people thought of him as cold or distant. He said that he knew that he was actually a vibrant and compassionate person, but that it takes time to really see that. It can be a very slow climb to get there.
Read
read an enemy's emails to learn how to beat them. Sharks are trying to, on Twitter, Clifton B says, what is a video game but an inconvenience turned into a novelty? Jesus should. Was that line as improvised as it seemed? Yes, it was extemporaneous in the moment. And I'm very flattered that you thought it poignant.
Balloon Nuts has a good one. The game is nothing but giant blocks of text.
Well, this is new for Coda. It's an actual puzzle. Go ahead and see if you can solve it.
Oh, shit. I'm now trapped.
So what's happening?
Well, we got a door that opens, mm-hmm. and a door that doesn't open. We got a switch that opens and closes this door. We have a background that cuts off our retreat. We open this door. It could be that we also have limited visibility. I'm gonna hit a bunch of other buttons. Just to see if there's maybe like a flashlight or something.
Sure. He's hitting the F keys. Oh, he's taking a screenshot. Okay.
All right, let me just walk you through it.
Thanks.
You're gonna hit the switch on the outside to open the door, then hit the same switch and walk through the door before it closes. You'll see a second switch on the inside, which will open the second door.
Will? Mm-hmm. Oh, this?
Don't forget that solution, because we're going to see this puzzle again soon. We're going to see it a lot.
That's amazing. So that's the meta-narrative. That's something that Valve has always been good about, is training you in early levels to expect the tricks that'll be tried
patterns
later.
Patterns and things.
Yeah. That's what Portal's all about, of course.
You were looking at those three dots earlier. I think you might have missed it, but those were in that spaceship game, too.
Okay.
They're in a hallway there.
I definitely missed it. All right, so I'm trapped in a room.
So that seems to be it, right? You walk down a corridor, you solve a puzzle, you get to the end. Simple enough. All right, now I'm going to modify the game again so that when you press enter, it'll remove all of the walls from this room.
What if I don't want that? I mean, I don't want to suspect our narrator of being unreliable, but I don't know. There's something to that. There's something to the fact that he sort of spells out that you're breaking Coda's game by pressing enter, but I'll go ahead and do it.
How about that? There was more to it than we had any way of knowing. I actually find it funny that this game comes after the Stairs game, since they essentially convey the opposite idea. So, in the Stairs game, a dull exterior concealed a rich interior. And then, in this level, a dull interior hides this fantastic outer world. Either way, I think that the point is the same, is that most of the time you don't get to know what you're missing, or even that you're missing anything. That's not your role as a player. So if your role here is not to understand, then what is it?
We're back at the path.
Aha! So, this, combined with the entering game from earlier, tells us that Coda believes his games are connected somehow. It could even be that the stairs game and the puzzle game are literally connected in between this and the entering game. There's a bigger picture that all of his games are meant to play a role in, some larger meaning that we won't be able to grasp until we've seen all of them. And once we have, we can step back and start to understand what exactly that bigger picture is.
This is what I picture the
afterlife. Let's talk about video game development for a second. Every video game runs on what's called an engine, which determines what the game can and cannot do. So in other words, the engine is a set of tools for game development. To make all of these games, Coda is using an engine called Source. Like all engines, Source has certain things that it does well, and it has certain things that it does poorly. One of the things that it does very well is boxy linear corridors. That's why so many of Coda's games are set in these large, flat, empty rooms, is just because he's working with what the engine does well. The tools available to the creator shape what kinds of creative work they're going to end up making. You might consider paying attention to the architecture in Coda's games, to notice how they seem to stem from an engine that's very good at producing linear, boxy corridors.
What's great is, by virtue of him appearing to peel back the curtain and let you in on fundamental aspects of gaming, it's the things he's not talking about that are the most fascinating to me, like the ambiance of the music and about the breaking of the fourth wall by having the narrator explain to you how you should feel.
Our resident game dev says, the game doesn't use anything but basic BSP brushes. It has no modeling. And then a little surprised face.
This prison, funny enough,
fuck
in
you.
Coda's original design, the door stayed shut for a full hour before letting you go. If you don't mind, I think we're gonna skip that.
You got that look in your eye.
I mean, it's, look, I played the Stanley Parable, right?
This is something that he and I used to argue about a lot. You know, whether a game ought to actually be playable, whether it means anything if no one can get through it. And I would always defend that, you know, all this work goes into the game, why not make it playable and accessible? And so we just got into heated arguments over it, and there was one time that after one of these conversations, he went home, and a day or two later, he sent me a zip file entitled Playable Games that was full of hundreds of individual games, each of which was just an empty box that you walked around in and nothing else. Believe me, I played every single one of those just to find out if there was like a gag hidden somewhere. There wasn't. It's the puzzle again, with the exact same solution as the last time. There's still no clear indication of what makes this puzzle so special that Coda is going to return to it over and over. But I promise, I'll share with you my interpretation very shortly.
Do you know what's wonderful about this is that it's using the, I don't know if I'm using the word right, but the patois of of short story analysis, the kind of talk that got us to roll our eyes in college English class. It's the analysis of video games as compelling narrative, as archetypal, humanity. I just love that we live in this world where this is where we're at.
And that there's value in the critique.
Yeah.
Here,
and that maybe the critique is the game itself.
System that he fashioned out of the engine's chat capabilities. Use the 1, 2, 3 buttons on your keyboard to respond.
You had to pass through. No, I've been right here this entire time. I suggest you go and see the puzzle sometime. It's not meant to be solved, but you can sit in the black space in the middle. Why would I sit in the black space? Oh, it's plenty peaceful. It may not seem that way at first, but you'll come to think so in time, eventually. To spend a lot of time in a black space, that might not be fun.
And so we make one last descent down to the final floor of the level.
It's my old dorm.
It's a lamppost. Okay, I can't tell you quite why, but for some reason, Coda fixates on this lamppost. It's going to appear at the end of every single one of his games from here on out. I'll tell you what I think. I think that up to this point, you know, he's been making really strange and abstract games with no clear purpose, and maybe you can only float around in that headspace for so long. Because now he wants something to hold on to. He wants a reference point. He wants the work to be leading to something. He wants a destination. Which is what this lamppost is. It's a destination. We're gonna see it in the work as well. His games are just gonna become a lot more cohesive, a lot more fully developed, with more of a clear idea behind them. And as we go, that idea will get clearer and clearer and clearer.
So it's here where I would suggest maybe hitting escape and pausing momentarily to reflect.
Before I begin?
Yeah.
Okay.
So you've played through a couple of levels now.
Yeah, yeah.
You're starting to see what looks like some cohesiveness.
We're seeing a story of two narratives. You have, in the short term, a sequence of short stories of short, seemingly pointless games. But you're also being told the story of a character who is erratic and unreliable by a narrator who, while we know his name and we know his reputation for having done the Stanley Parable, is himself somebody that I don't entirely trust. We're being put in a position to ruminate on what is it we're supposed to think, which to be honest, is one of the few things that separates video games from all other narrative mediums. Nobody pauses a movie to ask, so what do you think's happening right now? Is Tyler Durden real? I don't know. And then most certainly the movie is not affected by what you think. Mm. But video games are, in that if you suspect that there's a key hidden in the room, you spend hours and hours and hours looking to that key. If anyone saw me play Return to Castle, or the latest Wolfenstein, you saw me rage about the wasted hours I spent because I felt like the game was telling me to be, think, and react to one thing, mm-hmm. when in fact it was working under a totally different set of rules. Knowing that this is from the guy who wrote the Stanley Parable only puts me more on guard in that regard. And that's not necessarily a bad thing. I don't resent the fact that I took the long way up the stairs to get to the inside of the building, mm-hmm. but I don't know what to think of the narrator. I do know that a la Mr. Robot, if nothing else, I do trust that he's setting up a bigger, more interesting story. It sounds like from what he said, we're about to go on a set of more traditional video games with a traditional narrative, but it sounds like underneath all of that, there's going to be bigger things I should be looking out for. And not that I resent the hint, but I find it significant that you pointed out that there were those three dots inside the prison level, and I had missed them before. And I feel like starting now, I have to be on guard, because I think there's going to be less hand-holding moving forward.
So you feel
forward.
Suspicious?
Yes.
Do you have any reaction to like the concrete data that's been given? Like, do you have a response to the work that you're being presented?
It seems fairly traditional video game work. It sounds like. It's tough because I only have the one time that I've done it, so I don't know how things would have gone if I had reacted differently to different things, but I have the distinct impression that everything I've done so far is what I'm expected to do. The only time I really felt like there was a choice was when I decided to slowly walk up the stairs rather than speedily walk up. I guess I was also given choices when I spoke to the TV-headed guys. So at this point, I don't know what to think. I suspect that I'm about to enter a more traditional gaming environment where there'll be an objective and I have to solve puzzles and get there. However, I also suspect I'll be judged on how I handle them.
Okay. Cool.
By the way, these are close to in the source engine.
So first off, I'm sure you can deduce this, but this game is not connected to the internet. All of the notes that you're going to see have been written by Coda. This was actually the first game of his that I ever played. This was shortly after I met him at a weekend game jam in Sacramento, where I grew up. I saw him working on this very level, and it was just so different from anything that anyone else was doing. So right away I was like, I have to be friends with this person. In retrospect, I think I was probably a bit too pushy trying to get his attention. I was over-enthusiastic. But he was very gracious about it and very patient with me. And I cooled off eventually. Feel free to skip over any of these notes if they're not doing anything for you. Nothing extra is going to happen if you read all of them. Either way, to me they convey a sense of loneliness. I see this person who's filled with thoughts and feelings and beliefs and has no way to express them except as scattered and unheard voices in a game that wasn't meant to be played. But it's ironic, isn't it? That in playing this game and seeing how alone Coda often felt, that we get to know him better and actually kind of connect with him. And I have to be honest with you, this idea is really seductive to me. That I could just play someone's game and see the voices in their head and get to know them better and have to do less of the messy in-person socializing. I could just get to know you through your work. I think this is why I always liked Coda's games so much, is because it felt like they let me have that connection. I felt as though he was inviting me personally into his world. And then I feel less lonely too.
Boy, there's a lot of messages.
Not realize they turned gray after you nailed them. But our narrator assures us that you don't need to see all of them. That saw a person walking down there, now we'll come back, reminds me of Dear Esther. There was a number of moments like that.
Oh, yeah?
Yeah, because it's like a haunted island. You could...
Oh, yeah, no, I played. Yeah. That's interesting, because I guess maybe it's the way I played Dear Esther. I actually felt disconnected because it felt so apparently empty.
Yeah. Well, apparently, like, there were ghosts walking around and all this stuff, but you had to, you know, take your time to really soak everything in.
At the end of this level, we're going to see the puzzle again. And here, I'll tell you what I think the puzzle means. Each of these games represents an idea that was on Coda's mind at the time that he was making it. And the puzzle is a way of closing the door on a previous chapter of his life before moving on to the next one. In each of his games, after exploring a theme that, you know, he might find difficult, Coda can then place this puzzle that he knows has a reliable solution, he understands exactly how it works, and so it gives him a simple mechanism for moving on.
Thank you.
This is the moment I feel like we're led to...
And because there's this dark area between the doors, a space between spaces, before you move on, you get to pause. Just for a moment, a few seconds to reflect on and let go of the events that led you here. To step back and connect the pieces together, to grasp at that elusive bigger picture.
I feel like, let's go ahead and try. I also feel like it could trap us just in there. And I don't know, there's a sense of danger to this game. In the movie, The Neverending Story, the guy says, have you ever been Captain Nemo trapped in your sub while a giant squid is attacking you? And the kid says, yes. And he says, well, were you scared? He goes, no, why not? He's like, well, because it's a book. He's like, that's right. It's safe. This book is not safe.
Right, because you are actually between the doors.
Exactly. Like, if I go in there and I shut it, I feel like I don't trust this game to not just fucking trap me in there.
What would...
I mean, you don't need to shape... I'm just vocalizing. Okay. Fuck it. Yeah. Huh. I didn't expect it to be as easy as it looked.
Okay, this one is tough. It's gonna kind of just spin its own wheels for a few minutes. Hang with it.
What's fascinating is how much longer I'll put up with horseshit, knowing all I need is a relatable narrator to tell me to hang in with something, and I will so much longer.
See, like, this is it, the whole game, and there's nothing that's particularly interesting about it. You just walk to the end of a hallway. Except, for some reason, Coda gets really fixated on this prison that has all of this modern furniture. And I don't know why, but he decides he needs to revisit this prison. He's gonna start over, use the same assets, turn it into something else. Okay, cool. Here's version two.
I guess if there's one thing I could definitely rely on our narrator to do, mm-hmm. is to keep...
It says, what furniture should go in the center of the room?
Yeah, how about a TV with surround sound, a refrigerator? A refrigerator. Doesn't matter what you say.
What should go along the
wall? Tin stoves lined up against the wall. Yeah, doesn't matter.
You can rely on the narrator to...
To move the narrative forward. So far, he's never let me be trapped in a boring thing. And it's clear that it doesn't matter what I say. It's going to put the same shit on there.
There's a bit more to this one, but still, it's not really communicating anything. It's kind of just weird for weirdness' sake.
It's great the way the narrator short-circuits.
So, okay, he throws it out and starts over. This time he comes at the prison idea from a different direction.
Circles. Fuck. Was I supposed to remember all that?
And of course, now the table is gone and you can't begin the chain of events to escape. Here's a version where there are no bars, but you can't actually get to the well. And then a version where the inside of the prison is the outside and the outside is the inside. Let me just blink you real quick through a few more of these. I mean, he really unloaded on this prison idea. There's nearly a dozen of them. Personally, I think it's awful to watch this, to see a person basically unraveling through their work. And for what? Like, at what point do you just go, maybe there are game ideas other than this prison that I could be working on? But Coda doesn't have that voice telling you to stop, that particular mechanism of defense against yourself. Without it, you just spiral. And so he keeps going and going and going and going and going, and then he hits on something. And he likes it. And that's it. He's done. He stops making prisons. This is the very last version of the prison game that he created, and the reason I think it works is that the prison is not actually in it.
Hello, who's this? Hey, it's me. I'm you from After You Escape the Prison is the only choice I have. You're me? So you're trapped in this prison too?
It's a conversation. And so this is what Coda wants, is to be able to talk to someone, to share what's on his mind, and to get some good advice from someone who knows. But the irony is that even in this scenario, you're still talking to yourself. You know, all of these games so far are Coda talking to himself.
Actually, I'm already forgetting what being in the prison was like. Only a few minutes, but somehow it's already fuzzy like it never happened. Worst, most desperate thing I've ever been through. How could you possibly forget it? You don't ever forget it. You just stop identifying with it. Yeah, that's accurate. Wait, if you're me, then did you get a call from another version of you when you were trapped? No, I'm the first person to call back. Can you tell me how to get out? Maybe I could come find you. What do I have to do? Get out, you need to get out, just talk with me for a bit. What? That'll free me? How does that work? Just talk to me. Okay, I could talk. Let's just talk for a bit. Will you be here? We'll be here for as long as you need.
I can see why he considers this a fitting conclusion to the prison games. After all of the obsession and frustration, just to be told by someone you can trust that things are going to be okay, wouldn't that be nice? So what would it look like if Coda wanted to make a game about talking to someone other than himself? To me, this environment is meant to represent Coda's puzzle, with the two doors on either side and a dark transitional space between. Just so you're aware, nothing will happen up here until you've been inside the house.
He's never lied to me yet. Goodness, I'm glad as all heck you showed up. Thought I might be having to clean this house all by myself, and that right miserable that would have been. Everyone knows lonesome hands make lousy homes.
You'll notice that the quality of the art is a step up from previous games, yeah. Including this new and improved chat system, which he started using from this point on. From here on out, he begins putting much more effort into the visual polish of his work, and this particular game took 2 months to create as a result. After the intense set of prison games, this house cleaning level almost feels like cleansing. It's the moment after a particularly difficult or traumatic experience where you just need to let it sit and digest inside of you, and eventually cohere into something meaningful. I know that Coda really liked this game. Of all of his work, actually, this was the only one that he called me up to ask me to come over and look at it. This was during a period of a few months where he was, like, grossly happy all the time. Just walked around with a constant smile on his face. I'm glad he made this. I'm glad he found some peace. But, of course, it can't last. The music stops, your companion is gone, it's time to leave. The door at the top of the hill is now open as well. Again, You can't stay in the dark space for too long. You just can't. You have to keep moving. It's how you stay alive.
This reminds me of, within the Source Engine Pantheon, Half-Life 2 has a delightful moment where what they're really doing is they're training you how to use Dog and use the gravity gun, but it's a moment of peace and quiet like that in between great periods of conflict. Mm. You play
Which is
fetch.
The whole point of the puzzle doors, right? That sooner or later you have to pick up and move. I really thought that was the point of it. This one gets a bit goofy.
I cannot move.
About halfway through the game, the perspective shifts. And you play as the teacher. And suddenly, you discover that your teacher is just as bigoted and afraid as you are. Oh, and also you can move around the classroom now. Pretty hard for this one. I feel like it's one of the most relatable experiences that you can have. To assume that some other person is perfect and totally fulfilled in every way and completely miss all of the little flaws that make them painfully human.
All right, hold on. Let me readjust this level so that you can see some of the text a little bit easier. I'll kind of move this over here. Make that a little bit bigger. So we're like that.
Boop. Oh, that's good.
All right.
I think about this game a lot these days.
What?
You wrote the end of it.
Good.
This one took a lot longer than all the others for Coda to make. It was 4 months between this and the last one. That's twice as long as it took him to make any other game before this, and it's God not damn. Like it's particularly complex, so I remember I found that a little strange at the time.
Dude, this is so weird, like just seeing this much, it's like this is a fucking decade and a half of my life is seeing this scene.
Oh, interesting.
This is my real ass life, and every college performing arts auditorium, every Mason's Club that CJ performed at and I had to run tech for. I mean, yep, this is what it looks like.
Thank you. The game ends with this eerie premonition of what's going to happen next in Coda's life. The solution to social anxiety, to fears of having to perform and having to chase success, the answer for Coda is to withdraw, to hide himself away. Which is what leads to scenarios like the stairs that slowed you down several games ago, where it just becomes harder and harder to access Coda's inner landscape because he keeps retreating. He just keeps backing away from possible connections to anyone other than himself. And to be honest, I didn't consider it very healthy when I first played this. You know, it looked to me like he was trying to justify the idea of just disconnecting yourself from the world. And that wasn't what I wanted for him or for his games. Because I feel like a lot of his games are inviting me to connect with this person, to bring him closer. But what can you do? After this, Coda went off and took another 5 months to make a new game.
Should I keep my eyes closed? No. Yeah, that's dumb.
You should probably open your eyes if you haven't already. It's pretty much impossible to solve otherwise. And there is a solution, by the way.
All right, well, you only get two questions per iteration, and the questions change, so I feel like I'm just supposed to go through this a bunch of times. Keep running to the captain as if...
Let me explain how you're supposed to do this. On either side of the room are elevators, which go up to an upper level. You have to go up, walk over to the person who's standing there, and then select dialogue option number 2. Like I said, I was getting concerned. First off, he's never been this explicit in his work about exactly what he's thinking. So where's that coming from? But then even weirder, his work has potentially stopped being an outlet for him. Not like he's having trouble iterating on ideas, but he literally just can't think of new ideas anymore. And in person, he was being a lot more distant than usual. Like, you know how sometimes a person will just deflect anything that you say in order to keep themselves disconnected all the time? It was that kind of thing. Here was the point in my relationship with Coda where I really started to wonder if he needed my help in some way. His games are going to get more desperate from here on out. After this game, it's almost 6 months before he finishes something new. If the last game featured Coda talking explicitly about his creative frustrations, this one turns it up to 11. Now, put yourself in my shoes playing this. Here's a friend whose work is exhibiting signs of struggle, frustration, anxiety, depression, even. And yet, still, he keeps making games. He keeps throwing himself into the grinder even when he clearly doesn't have the energy for it anymore. Why? What is it for? Because from my perspective at the time and just what I knew of him, this was a result of how isolated he was. He was in his own little bubble, just sitting at his computer all day, not really showing these games to anyone, not releasing them onto the internet. And so he didn't have anyone outside of himself to connect with. He had no outlet to ground himself on. You can't talk yourself out of loneliness. It doesn't work that way. You can't be the one writing both the questions and the answers. Then there's no movement. Then there's no circulation. If all of your anxieties are being channeled into your work, then if the work ever fails, you have no backup and you're just going to crash.
It's
Seeing this game at the time that he made it, it looked really unhealthy to me. I was watching him do this to himself, and I hated it. I hated seeing him so trapped. It's like, video games are not worth this amount of suffering. This is someone I really cared about. And I used to get so much joy out of seeing him create. For him to suddenly become angry and frustrated like this, it was the worst thing. I don't know. This is what I felt at the time. I don't know how else to explain it. I wanted it to stop more than anything. I had never felt so rotten. I needed more than I had ever needed anything for this to stop. But it didn't stop. After finishing this one, Coda takes another 7 months and comes up with a new game. And of course, it's the machine.
It's awfully similar to the Steam logo.
Oh, yeah.
Man, this
shit. Remember, you can click to fire the gun.
What were we gonna say?
Shit's almost a little too real.
Oh, I understand.
so now the work is becoming self-destructive. And I'll tell you, at the time that I first played this game, shortly after he made it, here's what I'm thinking to myself. I'm thinking that Code is stuck in his own head, and that it's having a very negative effect on him, and that all he needs to do is just start showing his work to people, to get some actual feedback on his games. It might get him out of isolation. And so, as I'm thinking this, I realize that I could be the one to initiate it. Because it would never occur to Coda to start actively soliciting feedback, so what if I did it for him? If he could see the difference it would make to have more actual conversations with other human beings, would that bring him out of his mental spiral? Would it give him confidence in himself? Would it bring meaning back into his work? So I started showing Coda's work to people. I took this one, and the islands which you just played, the theater, the notes, the house cleaning game, and some of the prison escape games. I brought them to people that I knew and trusted. I asked their opinions. And the great part is that they really loved his games. You know, the point of it all was just to give him some external reference point, but they genuinely loved his work. There was nothing for him to be afraid of. Can you see why I felt like this was the right thing to do? Because it's the thing that I always feel like I need, to be told that my work is good, that I am good. When someone really connects with a thing that I've made, when they see themselves purely in my work, there's nothing that feels better. And I got to give that very same feeling to my friend. I did something, I really felt like I'd done something good, like I was a good person. I felt like there was a friend who was in trouble and was unhappy and maybe didn't like themselves, and I could fix it. If I could give him this gift, maybe I could fix the problem. When they told me how much they enjoyed his games, it was the best feeling. It was the absolute best feeling. It made me feel so happy, so beautifully, beautifully happy. So anyway, Coda finishes this game, and then really he just kind of takes off for a while. So this is June of 2011, and I didn't hear anything from him for several weeks, I guess. And so out of nowhere, one day I get an email, and it's got a private link to a new game of Coda's. This one is called The Tower. And to my knowledge, it's the last game that Coda ever made. So let's take a look. And this is where I have trouble saying anything meaningful about Coda's work. Because more than anything else, the tower just feels distant. It feels like it's trying to distance itself from the world. It's a very cold game. This room actually has a maze in it. Except that all the walls of the maze are invisible. And then every time you touch one of the walls, there's this awful flashing and noise. So the experience is really miserable. The game goes beyond not being meant to be played. It actually seems to despise the player for trying to play it at all. But I do want to show you the rest of the level, so when you're ready to continue, press enter and I'll put a bridge over the maze. Thank you. And to be fair, it's not like this is the first game that's needed some modification to be playable. Like the house cleaning game. You know, that one used to actually loop the cleaning chores and you just cleaned a house forever. I had to cut it off so that you could exit the house and the game would actually end. But that game had an idea that it was actually trying to communicate. What's the deeper idea behind the invisible maze? The only way past this challenge is to randomly guess the 6-digit code. Like the invisible maze, it's frustrating to me, because it's the opposite of everything else that Coda has made. It doesn't encourage thought or engagement. It doesn't ask anything of me, except a lot of my time. If I could have reached him during this time, then maybe I could have asked him, but I couldn't. I still don't really understand why this is here. I'll put the code on the ground for you here, though, so that we can move on. The switch to open this door is actually on the other side of the door, meaning that it's literally impossible to solve from this side. So even if you somehow brute-forced your way through the first two challenges, and you got to this point, there's actually just no way to progress. And it's scary for me, the idea of Coda cutting himself off entirely, just saying, you know, that's it, that's the end of the conversation, not giving me any way to fix the problem. I feel like a failure, I guess, when I can't fix the problem. But I can open this door for you, so let me do that. Was I a failure for not understanding this game? I mean, I don't know why I would be. It's not like everything needs to have a solution, but I feel it somehow. I feel like I failed, and I don't understand why. I remember, it's June of 2011, I'm playing this for the very first time, and as I'm playing, I'm thinking to myself, I don't know this person. I have no idea who this person is. It wasn't the guy I knew, it wasn't my friend. I had come to so many conclusions from looking at all of his work up to this point, and then suddenly none of them... I had been trying to, though, that was the thing. For years, I was trying to get to know him, to understand who he actually was and what he stood for. I asked him so many times to please just tell me what his games mean to him. I asked him please to tell me what the three dots mean. And he wouldn't. I just felt so strongly that if I could have connected with him, that if I could have somehow made his work my own, that I would finally be once and for all happy. It was that I needed to see myself in someone else. I needed to be someone other than me. But he stopped and left, and it felt somehow like I had failed. Where did I screw up? I'm the reason that you stopped making games, aren't I? It's because of what I did. I poisoned it for you. I don't think I ever told you this, but when I took your work and I was showing it to people, it actually felt... it felt as though I were responsible for something important and valuable. And the people who played them, they treated me like I was important. They really listened and cared about what I had to say. Even though I was showing your work, it was... I felt good about myself. Finally. For a moment, while I had that, I liked myself. And then you stopped, and I didn't have anything left to show people. I just had to be with myself. And as soon as that happened, there was no feeling at all. Nothing. Less than nothing. What does that mean?
I don't know if anything's going to change, but this book is this story is a scathing indictment against video game publishers. This is a fucking hate letter written to Activision.
I'm afraid that I did something really stupid because I don't like myself. That's why I'm releasing this collection of your work, is because I haven't been able to find any other way to reach you. I've tried everything. And so a part of me has hope that if I put this compilation out into the world, and if I put my name on it, that maybe enough people will play it so that it'll find its way to you, so that I can tell you that I'm sorry. I know I screwed up. If I apologize to you truly and deeply, will you start making games again? Please, I need to feel okay with myself again. And I always felt okay as long as I had your work to see myself in. I mean, is something wrong with me? Because I know that I did an awful thing, and I'm doing it again right now. Like, I'm showing people your work, but I can't stop myself from doing it. That's how badly I need to feel something again. Like, I'm an addict. There has to be something wrong with me. Can I apologize? What if I tell you I was wrong? Will that work? Will that fix it? I don't know. I don't think it will, but there's nothing else that I can do. Just tell me what you want. I'm sorry. I'm sorry. Please, start making games again. Please help me. Please give me some of whatever it is that makes you complete. I want whatever that wholeness is that you just summoned out of nothing. You put in your work. You were complete in some way that I never was.
Fuck, am I part of the art project in that? Am I the activation of this? Is this a fucking scathing indictment of the Twitch culture? This idea that fucking, is this an indictment of Night Attack, of Reddit? This fucking belief that because you show something that someone else created, you're special.
I want to know how to be a good person. I want to know how not to hate myself. Please. I'm fading. And all I want is to know that I'm going to be okay.
Huh.
Love, more praise, more people telling me that I'm good. Always more, more, more. It's like a disease. Solution, solution, solution. I guess if someone had told me ahead of time that he just really enjoyed making prison games, maybe I wouldn't have thought he was so desperate. I wouldn't have told so many people that he was depressed. Maybe he just likes making prisons. Even now, the disease is telling me to stop. Don't show people what a shitty person you are. They'll hate you. If I knew that my life depended on finding something to be driven by other than validation, what would that even be? It's strange, but the thought of not being driven by external validation is unthinkable. Like, I actually cannot conceive of what that would be like. What now? I think I need to go. And I'm sorry, because I know that I said that I would be here and I would walk you through this, but I'm starting to feel like I have a lot of work to do. I have a lot that I need to make up for, and so I'm just gonna... Okay.
If we don't go. Is this one of those false choices? Knowing that, well, I guess that answers that. Hey, Penelope. Come here. Yeah, okay. Come here. I want to interview about... Come here. Penny. She's gone.
You look affected.
Annoyed. I'd hate to say it, but it seems like it was almost an indictment of the editorial process of publishing and publishers in general, how they take the work of other people and try to force a narrative on it. And yet I'm left with the strong, strong impression that this game would have been much better had a publisher fucking forced a narrative onto it. Instead, I'm left with this weird, vaguely tickly cock tease of
a self-destructive frustrated moral.
Well, yeah, it's fucking, you kind of prove the point. Fucking, you can't do it on your own, Coda. This is what it looks like when you don't do it on your own. You need a fucking grown-up to put a lamppost at the end. Otherwise, why are you making this horse shit? It's all fucking mazes in a notebook that nobody will ever see. Mm-hmm. I feel like in trying to indict someone, it proved their point.
Really? That's fascinating. I've looked up a lot of reactions. I feel like that's kind of an uncommon reaction. That what Davey did was a good thing. That by taking these things that...
But the problem is that fucking Davey needs a Davey. Davey released a Coda. He didn't fix nothing. Coda had an incomplete... Coda had delightful ideas that were incomplete. They lacked... They were not implemented. They lacked implementation. And as a result, they sat there half-finished... And Coda resented Davey's attempt to to fix them. Davey himself gives up before the end of it and just wanders off. And we're left with another Coda. Fucking, we need Davies who aren't going to be Codas. We need Davies who are Davies.
Wow. Like, Coda didn't want anything out. Coda intentionally didn't want any of the stuff on the internet.
Yeah, okay, look,
Davey went against Coda, against Coda's.
That's right.
Wishes.
Okay, look. Coda's crime was that he was masturbating.
I mean, this is just a kid. Well, that's the thing. There's no crime in jerking off.
No. That's correct. But then Davey comes in, and Davey starts masturbating, and he needs the tool of Cody's material, and he starts jerking himself off.
Well, that's mutual masturbation.
But the point is, meanwhile, I need this shit because I'm the one jerking off, and each step underneath hasn't finished the job. And as a result, I personally, Brian Brushwood, am left the one who hasn't been able to bust a nut because nobody else did their fucking job. Coda didn't do his job. Davey didn't do his job. Now I'm left half erect with my dick in my hand, and I'm mad at both of them.
Uh-huh.
Fucking, if you're gonna fucking put a lamppost at the end, and they didn't even do that on the game.
They did.
No, they didn't. Yeah. They didn't.
They put the transporter there. See, the whole conceit of the original spaceship level was that...
No, I'm aware of the self-recursive nature of the fact that something at the beginning showed up at the end.
No.
But they didn't have the balls to state their thesis. They fucking... You have a thesis. Have a take. Don't suck. Fucking... It's by refusing to finish... They both refused to finish. Coda,
wow.
This is the story of the tragedy of artwork that doesn't complete itself, and we end up with a narrator who doesn't finish it, who doesn't complete it, and as a result, we're left with somebody who just shrugs his shoulders and wanders off. You know, I mean,
I'm not trying to combat you. So
well, and I understand that's the point of the art. The point of the art is, oh, look at this. I'm telling you one story, but secretly I am the other story, the same story.
Mm-hmm.
But anyway, it just makes me realize that. Anyway, I'm sorry. What
Can I give?
Yes, please,
if you care.
Please. Yes, I do. I do. I do.
I think the big story of the Beginner's Guide is about respecting the producers, respecting creators. I think Davey at no point either thought these these levels were good enough to share, or for whatever reason chose not to share them publicly, even though the reception was glowing. And by Davey co-opting and perverting Coda's work by introducing lampposts, he has taken it upon himself to try to string together not just Coda's own work, which is its own infringement, but Coda's identity by impressing on other people that Coda was depressed, that Coda was struggling, that Coda was being self-reflective in these games, which, you know, could have just been more than a lark.
Just whimsy. And first of all, for the record, let me state unequivocally as art, this did a fantastic thing in that it made me feel something very strongly, and that's extraordinarily difficult to do. What I think is interesting is in the chat, somebody says, but Coda didn't owe Davey anything. Does Davey owe you anything? And I think that's the question is, you're right. Coda didn't owe Davey anything, but Davey felt entitled to it. Yeah. But in the narrative, Davey is an
entitled...
He's an entitled cunt, right? Okay. But meanwhile, I spent $10. I am owed something, you know? And granted, I'm getting what I'm owed right now. Yeah. You know, the great art has the ability to create deep emotions of people, and one of those emotions can be rage and frustration. You know, all my favorite things leave me with more questions than answers, and this certainly did. Mm. But
if you were, I want to pose a hypothetical.
By the way, for the record, I loved it, and I think it's very, very good. I started off wanting to like Coda and wanting to like Davey, and I'm left liking neither of them. I think both of them are flawed, shitty individuals. Not the actual Davey, but I mean the Davey of the character of as Davey as consumer, as curator, because in so many ways Davey represents everything that I hate about Reddit. And there's a lot to love about Reddit, but what I hate is this entitled sense they have that they're the important ones because they're the ones showing you someone else's work. And in that regard, I think it beautifully put that together. And I also think it was poetic that the mirror got turned so far around in that this is a fantastic game to Twitch stream, and yet it's almost embarrassing that you're practically called out for the fucking artistic cowardice of being a Twitch streamer. You know, Davey is a coward in this, you know. Coda is the prey of Davey the coward. And yet, unfortunately, that nature shines a spotlight on me, the player, and it makes me a coward, an artistic coward. That it's almost as though the point of all of this is, why don't you fucking make something instead of play fucking video games, you piece of shit? Like, that is a very loud theme of this. Davey is a coward because he sits there consuming and trying to find importance in Coda's work. And yet, here I am, fucking Davey Prime, looking at Davey's work, feeling the same way, running my stupid mouth off like I know a thing, and I can ascribe meaning to the work of Davey, who all he wanted to do was make some whimsy and release it to the world. I resent Davey for shining that spotlight on me, but I admire the art for the same thing. And not the actual Davey, I mean the art.
Yeah,
the
I think that's kind of a given that we mean the character being represented as Davey here.
Yeah.
I think that's fascinating. When you got to the end there and you made the point about feeling like there was a tie, an attachment there to part of Night Attack, that was a pretty big revelation, because I had never considered... I think the distinction I make between those two, and whether or not it's significant or not, is that Night Attack, and I guess Reddit on the whole, is that that's dealing with generally public information. You know, where we're talking about, you know, this is a YouTube video that's public. This is a web tool that's cool. And
I mean, but often it's not. Oftentimes it's what the things we respond to the most are the ones that are private moments that happen to be recorded by someone else, right? So it's almost this invasion of privacy, the way we're seeing, you know, Coda's motivations called into questions on everything by Davey.
I think probably the moment that I had the most intimate connection was in the middle of that housekeeping game.
Mm-hmm.
But you seemed you had a really strong reaction to the backstage area.
Oh shit! Yeah, yeah. No. Because that was very real to me, I mean, there was like this wave of gig time coming over me.
Did the ideas of that game resonate much with you as well? Since part of that game is about performing and there being sort of stakes, even though the end conclusion was sort of withdrawal. Because knowing you, that's not you at all. In fact, your reaction so much has been the opposite to go against the tide and to continue to create and push in the face of depression and
I guess that's the thing is in my own life and by the way Carl makes a very very good point of he gave out his actual email on the game, and if I had a pair of balls I would say any of this to him directly, but I'm not interested. I'm not the least bit interested in having an actual conversation with the actual person about the actual art, because I'll just feel dumb and I'm too scared. However, I'm very interested in talking out my feelings about this art project. And it's a fantastic art project, in that, you know, great art will make you angry. And I felt angry, and that's what makes this a great piece of art. I didn't detect until you just said that like to me the feeling of being backstage meant something. I knew exactly where I was, exactly what I was about to do. I knew it was gig time and I got to walk a fuck out and do the thing.
Mm-hmm.
And as I'm, you know, you walk out and you ask the questions or whatever, and then everything goes sideways. I felt instantly detached from the game because it's like, well, I don't know how I felt.
Because knowing you, you are very good at handling situations like that, where if something goes sideways or something twists, that you can reconfigure.
Right, the ship.
And I
think that's why I detached from it, is because they were all nonsense options. You know, it's like I could tell as I was playing it, I was like, well, none of this is riding the ship. This is all picking different, you know, pins to fling yourself against. Whatever, fine. Let's fling ourselves against.
Like, do you think that's a personality difference? Do you think that maybe as someone who, now this is reading into Coda, but as someone who might not have those personality traits or that social experience?
I mean, isn't that it?
By asking that question, it's its own damnation.
No. I at the risk of being that guy who finally has read, you know, Carl Jung and wants to tell everyone that he now can categorize everyone. Like, isn't that the difference between introversion and extroversion? Davey is an extrovert who defines his meaning through the reflection of what other people say about him, and in the absence of his own content, he relies on that of Coda. Coda is the introvert who creates for his own self, and whether something's ready or not ready, you know, he decides on his own.
Because Coda, we do know that Coda was sharing the works with Davey some point,
right.
and they were even able at some point in physical locations and being shown work, but yeah, that's yeah.
I mean, yeah. I don't know what the actual Davey, not the fictionalized Davey. I don't know what the actual Davey wanted me to feel. But the mere fact that I'm investing so much time and effort to figure out how I feel and why makes me admire the work all the more.
Can I give you my experience?
Yeah, please.
When I first started playing, I was actually really excited about the game. Because while I could tell pretty early on that the games probably are a creation for this experience, that the works, the levels of the Beginner's Guide are created for the Beginner's Guide.
Right.
But what I the message I enjoyed of it was something that you hit on pretty early, that it was a this is a weird thing to say, a consumerizing of difficult to consume media. And actually early on it was counter to your thought, where you chose to go slowly up the stairs. I chose to hit enter and go at full speed. And my appreciation for that was that I don't think it's presumptuous to say generally that it is accepted to have to take an anti-art stance, that it is not bewildering if someone writes something off as pretentious or hard to crack, you know?
State that again, if you would. I want to give...
Okay. So again, personally, I think that today it is generally acceptable to write something off as being pretentious or as being indecipherable.
Sure. Oh, no. Those are negative. Those are very rarely negative things to me. Pretentious is just a word for ambitious if you believe they didn't hit their mark. If you think they hit your mark, then they're ambitious. If you feel like they missed their mark, then you call them pretentious. So I'm not, never.
And I wouldn't attribute it to anybody specifically, but I just feel
right,
like.
Right. No. But I certainly don't feel like it's pretentious. I feel like it hits the mark.
But what I liked about it is that it was taking something that the public would consider pretentious and making it. It was starting a dialogue about critical thought and critical observation of media, even if the media was fake and that a larger message could be discerned later.
Yeah, I don't know that I could speak to that, but Carl in the chat makes a really interesting question. He says, you played this and brought it to me. Now that I played it, would I bring it to anyone? The people I thought of at first, of course, my brother.
Oh yeah,
and yet
he's big into game design.
The involuntary instant thought I had was, why would I do that to him? I would never do that to my brother. I would never, like,
wow. Yeah.
Why? Like, this is my brother's fucking life. This is all the shittiest parts about what it means to work in the video games industry, and I mean, it was uncomfortable for me, and I'm only feeling echoes of that kind of shit, you know.
Yeah.
Why would you do that to Jay? To fucking hey, try this drug. It's the distilled essence of everything that's agonizing about the career choice you've made.
You don't think that there is positivity to be taken?
No,
there is
zero positivity in all of this. I see nothing positive in this. This holds up a mirror to everything agonizing about. If Robin Williams was alive, this would make him kill himself again. This is fucking everything that's hard and wrong and awful about being an artistic creator of any variety. And in that regard, it is a triumphant success in that it distills it and speaks it in the language of video games.
And I think in the language of the common person. I think that the very specific grievances that you can attach to this game makes easily understandable to people who are outside of not just this industry.
I mean, I wouldn't know because I can't see it from their perspective, but I know that it was fairly brutal and head on from my perspective, you know.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. It is one of its greatest strengths is that it does the opposite of what video games are traditionally thought to do. It is the reverse of an escape. It is wrapped up like an escape, and instead...
When you open it, it says, don't tell anybody.
No, it's an escape But then you're like, oh, I'm going to play this game. And you open your eyes and you're fucking strapped to a chair and forced to watch the movie of how of the fucking it's like if PETA had it out for the video games industry, this is how they would force feed you to watch, like, fucking, you like video games. This is what it's made of. Fuck you. Wow. And oh, Carl, absolutely not. I would not ask for a refund. It did everything that it should. You know, it did everything that good art does, which is make you feel something powerful and put yourself in a place of introspection.
So what I'm feeling off of you is you said it yourself that it made you angry.
Yeah.
Do you think that by making these sorts of issues more well known, that it is a positive that other people understand that these things happen in many different creative industries, that people will pervert against a creator's wishes?
I feel like, for a multitude of reasons. I feel like that would belittle the art project to act like there's an agenda behind it. I suspect that Davey made this for a very specific person, whoever that for R is that mm-hmm. they say at the end. And in so doing, he created something beautiful that needed to be, you know, that he felt like needed to be released to the world. I am deeply averse to saying, like, oh, well, this lets people know about the secret of how their hot dogs are made, and finally we're telling them the real truth or whatever. Mm-hmm. Like, I think it's bigger than that.
Interesting.
Or smaller than that might be a better way to put it. I think that this is a very heartfelt, private meditation on the nature of, you know, whether Coda is himself from 4 years ago, whether Coda is a real person or whatever, you know, whether, you know, for all we know, this is, I could easily see this being something his wife said to him once. And that, you know, he's writing this from the perspective of his significant other, and that Coda is himself, you know, from 4 years ago when he was working on X, Y, or Z. I mean, there's a million lenses to see through them. And I feel like one of the shallowest is that it's a secret agenda statement.
Well, and I don't mean an agenda, but having played this, do you think there are any actions in your life or in your day to day that you would do differently? Do you feel like do you feel affected concretely in how you would react to, like, media or something? Like, and it's hard to try to get you to extrude on that a minute after you've finished.
I mean, there's certainly a significant moment in that, you know, I felt like the mirror was turned on myself, and I'm like, fuck, is this an indictment of what we do on Night Attack by taking content from other people and, you know, and reflecting it, and we feel like we're doing something funny or special or whatever, you know, by just making noise, you know, we're just fucking dogs barking at something beautiful. Mm-hmm. I don't know that it changes anything, because Night Attack is always and forever will be Night Attack. I don't know that we're suddenly going to become, you know, bridge constructors or sculptors or anything like that. It's fucking what we do. I do feel like, you know, when I try to figure out what this thing is, whether I'm me or whether I'm someone else, it's clearly a glass box with someone screaming on the inside. And the question is, what is he screaming about? And who's he screaming at? And you can make a case that he's screaming at all of us. He's screaming at, you know, Twitch people for fucking thinking they're doing something. Mm-hmm. He's screaming at producers for putting lampposts at the end of levels. Does that mean, and let's say we exactly identify it, and let's say Davey's watching and Davey says, that is what I was trying to say. I mean, does that mean that we stop putting lampposts at the end of levels? I don't think so. I mean, I think that ultimately it's a fucking voice in a box, and it doesn't, you know, no matter how clearly you hear it, it's still in a box.
That's interesting, because a moral that I pulled out of it is that by trying to find something that isn't there or hasn't even been exhibited in a way that could offer up any sort of deep insight, you are conflating, you are conflating or creating a persona divergent from the original creator by attaching, by looking at a screaming box and saying, if we figure out what the answer is to the screaming box, what you're doing is saying this is not a screaming box anymore. You're saying that this is a problem and has been and is solvable. When no. I think the beginner's guide says that sometimes problems aren't meant to be solved. Sometimes they're just meant.
Well, here's the thing: is ultimately, it's a contradiction of itself because the game begins by being playable only by virtue of Davy's alterations. You cannot get through.
Yes.
Swipe that. You cannot get through the invisible maze. You cannot puts a bridge over it. You cannot. You will not wait an hour to be let out of the game until he grants you the gift of opening the bars and moving it forward. Mm-hmm. So,
but the only unbeatable part of this game is the door at the very end, where there is absolutely no switch, where no amount of brute force will allow you to get through. Yeah. And in that sense, that level is at least in the sense.
First of all, we don't know that. If you believe that, it's only because you believe Davy. And Davy already is an unreliable narrator because he's the one who shaped your whole existence so far. He's all like, hey, don't bother trying to. But anyway, Coda was wrong on this thing, so I'm going to make you a bridge. Hey, Coda was wrong on this thing, so I'm just going to skip you up to the top of the stairs or whatever. Mm-hmm. So it's like you only know it's unbeatable because Davy told you it was unbeatable. And you were never given the choice to experience that on your own.
You do have the choice. What I would say is, I told you one of the first times I mentioned the game is that you can play the game without commentary. And when you go and play the game without Davy speaking to you, none of his modifications come through.
And is it solvable?
I don't think anybody has an answer to that yet, because I don't know that anybody has been able to brute force their way through yet. I could be wrong. It's been out only a few weeks. But what I would say is I think the ways that Davy lied to you in probably how Coda was living and acting in the addition of the lampposts, I feel, well, okay. Let me take one step back. There is only really one viewpoint of the beginner's guide that makes sense as a literal narrative. The only way that Davy narrating to you what's happening is if you presume that he is standing right next to you and is prefetching these games for you. Because he's clearly done by the end of the game. And what he is experiencing at the end of the game, reading the information, these letters to him, it seems at least that it's his first time seeing that message and understanding that the letter, that the game is meant directly to him. The only person who has dissected Coda's work. Nobody else is. There's no reason to believe anybody else would deconstruct Coda's work except Davy. And the only way you would get through those challenges is to deconstruct it.
Yeah. Okay. Well.
To get back to where I was, because I feel like I've lost it. With that narrative reading, I do believe Davy when he says that door, in as a player of the game, without deconstructing it, is unpassable.
Okay. I mean, and he certainly might be right. I mean, there are certainly true things Davey has said, and then there are not true things that Davey said, right? So it kind of moves the needle, not at all. He's still firmly established as unreliable, and with his own motivations in that regard.
Sure.
So you're left with what is
but
this?
What, I guess what is. How is the meaning different if there is a hidden pixel, that or a hidden?
Well, button? That's just it. Is we'll never know. We will never know because we don't get to see the version. We never see any of these games the way Coda intended them. Even if you don't have the narration, they are curated and placed in an order that shapes a narrative that perhaps Coda never meant there to be.
Mm-hmm.
And that alone, if you're going to step out of it, you know, what does that mean? You know, it could be an indictment of even the idea of art museum curators who arrange things in a pleasing way that seem to kind of tell a story that lead down a path. And it's like, you know,
but where curators create their own stories and try to create their own context, they are doing it. They are not trying to ascribe those to the artists. They're trying to ascribe to context.
I think very clearly they are trying to ascribe it to the artist. I think that's what this was all about.
But I'm talking about the specific example of a museum curator where they try to create the context of the time.
No. I think that they try to tell the story of the artist on the artist's behalf as well. You know, I went and saw when the big Van Gogh exhibit was in Washington, D.C., there was they had not all of Van Gogh's work. They had whatever pieces they happened to have, and they arranged them in an order that began with his early work that was more realistic, you know, the skull with the cigarette and all this stuff, and then him discovering, you know, his more impressionistic roots or whatever. And then, you read stories that lead up to it. The end of the narrative was very clearly you walking to, because it was the biggest, most recent, biggest of the pieces they had, him a sunflowers thing they had. If they had a different thing, they would have told a different story, right? But those were the pieces they had, so they arranged them to tell the story that they could. And so in that reason, I don't think there's a difference. I don't think museum curators are in any way exempt from the exact same, lens that I'm looking through Davey at. I think that all of us, you know, as much as I praise remix culture or whatever, I think this video game is an indictment of it. I think all of it is saying, like, you know, you don't know what the other person meant and you arranging these tracks in this order or overlaying them in this order or taking this quote from Shakespeare, you know, fucking none of you made any of this. This is all Coda's work and you're all Davies. And I think that's why I reacted so angrily, because I'm like, fuck you, the world needs Davies, only Davies that don't puss out halfway through and fucking have a crisis of conscience. Could have released a playable game if you stuck with it, Davey.
Can you expound more on that last bit? I don't understand what does Davey do to make this
give up and leave last act?
I worded that. What should Davey do to make this a better game?
As the game started, and again, I'm talking about within the context, we're talking about inside the box, right? Mm-hmm. Inside the box, the game starts off saying, like, hey, here's this flawed artist, Coda. I'm going to try to arrange all this crazy shit and fucking give you what I think Coda was trying to say, because Coda's a little bit crazy. Mm-hmm. And then what he should have done was fucking brought it all together and tied it up in a neat button, not inject himself into the fucking narrative, have a meltdown, and leave in the last act, because then he just turned into Coda Part 2.
Well, give me a hypothetical. Any possible...
I ain't gonna write Davey's fucking script here.
No, but I'm saying, like, anything. It can be wrong. How does Davey put a button on this where he explicitly tells you, where he explicitly shows that Coda was aware of what Davey was doing, Coda did not approve of it, and that it was from Coda's own mouth wrong?
I don't understand the challenge. Are you asking me to...
How do you put a button on something that has no place having a button?
Fucking turned out that fucking Rosebug was a sled and Spock died and fucking Kaiser Soze was the gimp all along. Fucking, this is the heart of all good storytelling. Mm-hmm. Teller wrote it in his letter to me 20 years ago. He said, put two and two in front of me, convince me they're five, then reveal the truth, four. And there was none of that in there. It was like there was no moment of, oh, fuck, I get it. It was right there in front of me the whole time. Like, and again, but that's not what he was trying to go for. But if you're asking me how they could have been something different, again, I'm not saying it should have been something different. I'm saying the fictional character Davey failed at his job. And you're asking me, well, how could he have done his job correctly? It doesn't matter because that's not the story we're telling. We're not telling a story where Davey does his job. We're telling a story where Davey doesn't do his job.
Well, I pose that question because Davey doesn't have a job.
Yes, he does. He's the fucking narrator, ostensibly the editor, ostensibly the creator of this package. The character Davey has a job.
Which he has no right to do. What we experience, we have no right to experience. If we're talking in the box... At the end of this game, you should feel bad having played it. Especially, I mean, not just having played it the way with Davey's modifications, but you shouldn't have played any of this at all.
No, fuck you. Okay. Do you feel bad watching the director's cut of Blade Runner?
No.
Do you?
Should I?
Well, it's not, that's all been like reformatted through the lens of just one guy who had a different vision, went back and changed everything, changed it again later.
I mean, the guy who was really at the helm of it.
Is that the definition? As long as he was at the helm, it's fine. So Harrison Ford doesn't get another take. He feels like there's another take that was better. Mm-hmm. And he used the shitty one.
But I'm not watching Joe Schmo's cut of Blade Runner.
Well, no, I mean, it's clear that Davey's not Joe Schmo, though. It's clear that Davey has a pedigree that gave. I mean, how did he? Fucking Coda gave him to him. He Coda kept sending it to him.
To play.
You don't know that. How do you know that?
He says at the very end, I didn't want anybody to play these. I didn't want you to show these. I didn't want that.
Why did he give them to Davey if he didn't want them to be played?
Because they were friends, dude.
You don't know any of that. Fucking Coda knows what Davey is. Davey's Davey. He's always going to be Davey. You're going to hand a pistol to a wolf. Wolf's going to shoot the rabbit. That's fucking what wolves do. Uh-huh. They shoot rabbits with pistols. And it's like you keep giving them ammo for this shit. You're like, I don't understand. What is this?
I think that's interesting. I don't attribute Davey as an unreliable narrator to be so unreliable to the point that he would hide or lie about Coda's wishes, especially when they're so hard-coded into that final level.
Hey, Callie.
Okay, so what about this? Have you ever seen Metropolis? The silent film?
Yes.
Okay. I love you too, sweetheart. There does not exist.
That's me.
That's you. Do you see you?
And that looks me.
That's right.
Hi, Callie.
Yeah, that's us.
Yeah.
So take something like Metropolis. Mm-hmm. There is no living person who knows what that was supposed to be. There is no edit of it that is the final version. The closest we have is it was
all
a revolution.
All those cuts that were... Some of those cuts were shown.
And then they edited in new footage. And then 10 years ago, they discovered a print from Argentina that was the most complete. Still not complete, right? Is that all Davies and we should resent that we have the latest cut? And by the way, the latest cut of Metropolis is a million times more watchable than anything that came before it. It's objectively better by every message. But by your logic, it was put together by a bunch of Davies who had no right to do so because they didn't get permission from the Codas who made it.
Sure. But
and meanwhile,
also, that film was shown. That film print was made. You know, there's a public thing. The intention was that Metropolis would be shown to the public. And as time has progressed, we have allowed ourselves to pervert older and older material in the name of media understanding.
Is the argument to be made that...
I mean, are you saying that we shouldn't know?
I mean, should we not show? I mean, some of Vincent van Gogh's art was sold with the intent of being displayed. others were intent, were created with the intent that he would keep them for himself. Mm-hmm. Are we Davies for having Vincent van Gogh exhibits? Showing art that wasn't meant with a narrative he did not intend.
Well, I think the narrative is a second string on this, but I think on some level, yeah, I think you're right, and I think that's part of what the game is trying to question.
Well, and again, outside of the box, the game's a delightful method to cause us to have these arguments, which is of exactly what the game should do.
Tanky
We're
says,
arguing about the nature of art and. Okay, the nature of art is art. I like it.
Tanky says, Davey is every Star Wars fan claiming George Lucas ruined Star Wars by doing his vision.
Yeah. Which is maybe why I identify with Davey. I mean, maybe that's what this whole thing is about, is forcing you to identify whether you are identify with Coda or
whether
Davey.
Whether cultural works are the own are owned by the creator or not. Which I think is... he's gone through and started to play the space level without the commentary.
Yeah, sorry.
Is something at the center of copyright debate. At what point does a creation enter the public's consciousness? At what point do the people who have been immersed in creations own it?
Yeah.
Through public domain.
No, I think you are.
Hi, Callie.
Can you say hi, Callie?
Hi, guys. I love you twice and that.
Do you know what a jerboa is?
Yes, I've seen the jerboas. Look, they're cricket hamsters, basically, right?
Yeah. That's so icky.
All right, that's enough, you.
They're basically gerbils, but way cuter, and that's messy to get. Yeah.
So anyway, the good news is, like, it's not like we're going to resolve any of this, but this is a fascinating debate because,
it's an interesting perspective. I don't see a lot of people who are on Davey's side or think Davey has sort of the obligation.
Here's the thing. I was on Davey's side and then Davey failed me. Davey had a job to do and he didn't do it.
But all he
and Davey's job as, again, from Davey's perspective or from my perspective as a player, Davey's job was to clean up after the mess that Coda left behind, and then he didn't even do it. He just made another mess himself.
Which is so funny because I just think that obligation doesn't exist. That obligation is in this specific case,
I mean,
a perversion.
If you're gonna take the stage and have the spotlight on you and say thank you for your $10 ticket, you are obligated to present to me a completed product, not to get halfway through a story and then walk off the stage. That's what Davey did.
Well,
Davey promised me.
You're taking Davey in the box and Davey out of the box as separate people.
No. I am saying, well, first of all, art does not exist independent of its audience, right?
Did you even notice me?
I totally noticed you. I always notice you.
You should probably let him down.
All right, that's enough. I am talking about Brian Artist Consumer's relationship with fictional Davey, the narrator.
Sure.
And that is, in that regard, I had an expectation that I was about to see the Davey Show retrospective of my friend Coda, in which case I expected to see a beginning, a middle, and an end put together by Davey. And I did not. I saw a beginning, a middle, and him walk off stage. And I understand.
But you don't consider that an end? Like, is it just because it's unsatisfactory? In that context, I see a beginning, a middle, and an end.
Again, outside of everything, you know, outside of like actual Davey, who wrote this video game, yes, to him I say kudos to you. You made me feel rage and frustration. But within the art itself, Davey the character did not do his job. He failed to do his job. Now Davey the actual writer did his job of making me feel angry at Davey the character, but I don't see any other situation I'm supposed to feel.
Pokemon. I think this is a huge disconnect for me because the Davey character in the box, quote, his job the ending of he doesn't complete whatever he sets out to, which is to curate this whole thing.
Right.
But as a character in this narrative in the story, he totally completes his arc by realizing that everything he's been doing is a perversion of what he considered his friend's work. And
now,
realizing
this is good. This is actually a really good point you make, because you are seeing Davey as the main character. And from that perspective, I totally see it. But I am so accustomed in video games, I never see Davey as the main character. I see me as the main character.
Okay.
And me, the main character, had my tour guide bail on me halfway through, and that would have been fine if I felt like I was the hero for finding the thing or whatever. But this was so linear that the third act became me walking through and just Davey crying the whole time. And I was left feeling like Davey didn't do his job.
Well, that's it. Okay, so then that's a totally different contextualization.
Yeah, that's interesting.
Of these characters. What I do think though is the epilogue is definitely.
By the way, this is the best review show.
This is great.
We just did this.
We have sirens going on in the background, and three little girls and a dog.
so no, but that's a fascinating distinction,
because I think it, especially with the epilogue, which generally is not a you know, a lot of people are not exactly fans of. The epilogue is a very long way to say to confirm that Davey the character was telling mistruths by having the laser at the end actually float you up instead of. Like us assuming this is a spark for Coda, instead of realizing that is as intended.
Right.
It nails, I think, a couple of things that Davey is unreliable, and that Coda's works are potentially more finished or more intentional than we would consider them. That's your cop piece,
man. I feel like from here on out we just got to digest, because yeah. I think it's fascinating differences of what we explained, and again, nothing but high marks for Davey the actual human being to create something that would inspire, you know, because I liked the Stanley Parable a lot, but I don't remember arguing with anyone about it afterwards. Sure. You know,
well, because I think the Stanley Parable has a lot, says a lot of things, but it also says them pretty linearly.
Yeah.
Oh, we got the phones out now. One last thing I wanted to ask.
Yeah.
You were pretty suspicious of the game from early on. When we stopped and took a break, that was almost entirely what you remarked on, was
yeah.
that you thought a trick would be played upon you?
Mainly because that was my experience with the Stanley Parable, and that was the only sample I had beforehand, and that was the entire gimmick of the Stanley Parable, was that the narrator was unreliable, and that turned out to be disingenuous and, you know, have his own agenda.
I see. Do you think because I've talked to you, and I've tried to stay as ambiguous as I could about the game. Do you think that even the few things that I mentioned?
No, I felt like you were extremely fair in your cautious approach to. I think you were trying to tease out what I was thinking without leading me down any pathways.
Okay, because it's definitely for a game that I feel like doesn't want. You to tell people about. It's also very linear and very easy to spoil, as the literal contents of the game are pretty short.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. Oh. Okay.
Not again.
Uh oh.
Not again. The magic came. Well, how would you not balance it on my head?
Because the chaperone suggested.
Well. That'll be the last time we listen to them. All right, I feel like it's time. What was the other game I need to play? That
Keep Talking or We'll Explode.
Yes, yes, we should play that together.
Okay,
we'll print out that, that
right
manual.
Now.
Okay, look, Penny, come on, girl. All right. Wow. Well done,
yeah.
Real life Davey. your character doppelganger is a jerk who couldn't finish what he claimed to start, but you, the actual creator of this, certainly did.
I actually really like that our discussion didn't... There's a lot that can be read into actual Davey, who has had very public depression bouts.
And oh, really? Oh, no.
Issues with
all of my issues are with fictional version of Davey. Davey did nothing but awesome.
I actually like that we could read into these things without contextualizing it within his real world. Issues, and that we didn't spend so much time.
I didn't even know there were any. Maybe that's why that was so easy for me. Mm. I didn't know there were any other issues. All right, well, we're gonna shut down. Love you guys. Thank you, Chat Realm. Hope you guys enjoyed it. We got children. I lost my hat. What?